caucuses.
Good evening, and thank you for being with us. This is a night we have been waiting for a long, long time. The doors at caucus sites across the great state of Iowa have opened at this hour, and the voting, the actual voting, is finally about to get underway in the first contest of the 2012 Republican presidential race. The last time Iowa owned the national spotlight, it was this underdog senator from the great state of Illinois who made history on the Democratic side. That same night 4 years ago, the Republican Party's eventual nominee came in fourth place in Iowa. The Republican 4 years ago who outspent all other Republican candidates in Iowa combined that year, he also ended up losing that night. He lost to a former Arkansas governor who captured the hearts of Iowa evangelicals and took Iowa by storm. Mike Huckabee won the Iowa Republican caucuses in 2008 with a 10-point victory over the second-place finisher, Mitt Romney. Well, tonight, Mitt Romney is back. He is running at or near the top of the polls. His campaign had initially steered clear of Iowa this year, but now they are all in. The latest challenger to Governor Romney's frontrunner status is former Pennsylvania Senator Rick Santorum, a candidate whose cause was once so lost, he held an Iowa rally attended by one other person. But looking at him now, you would never guess that.
We've got the organization, and our money is coming in better than it's ever come in. And when we do well tonight, we suspect we'll have the resources to be able not just to compete in New Hampshire, but to compete all the way through.
After polling in 2008, 10% in the Iowa caucuses, Congressman Ron Paul standing in the polls now is roughly double that number, and his campaign is confident. They say the organizational demands of caucusing play to their greatest strengths as a campaign. Few Republican insiders believe that Congressman Ron Paul could be the one to win the nomination, but almost everyone believes tonight that he has a chance to win in Iowa. Former Speaker of the House and former Iowa frontrunner Newt Gingrich is not going down without a fight. He says his numbers have dropped from his frontrunner status because of other campaigns going so negative against him. He initially complained about that negativity, but now Newt Gingrich is fighting fire with fire.
Are you calling Mitt Romney a liar?
Yes.
You're calling Mitt Romney a liar?
Well, you seem shocked by it. Yes. Because this is a man whose staff created the PAC, his millionaire friends fund the PAC, he pretends he has nothing to do with the PAC. It's baloney. He's not telling the American people the truth. It's just like his pretense that he's a conservative.
Well, the Democratic incumbent, the President of the United States, Barack Obama, he'll be making his presence felt in Iowa tonight as well. He'll be holding teleconferences with Democratic Iowa voters. I'm Rachel Maddow here at MSNBC headquarters in New York City. Chris Matthews is leading our coverage from Des Moines, Iowa tonight. Let's say hi to Chris. Chris, how are you tonight? How's everything going in Des Moines?
Great, Rachel. You know, I think the big weapon out here we saw unleashed tonight and through these weeks leading up to the caucuses tonight is pretty ferocious. It's based upon a court decision, Citizens United. It allows a candidate and his rich allies to spend all kinds of money, in fact, unlimited money, destroying an opponent candidate without ever putting their names on that list, never identifying themselves, never associating themselves with the candidate they're favoring. They can destroy an opponent totally anonymously, and they can do it without ever hurting their own candidate. Now, of course, Mitt Romney's using that weapon in this campaign. He's used it to destroy, it looks like for purposes of tonight, Newt Gingrich. We'll see if he's destroyed him permanently. But the real victim, of course, is any kind of democracy as we know it. If you can run a campaign now with anonymous money, if you can use it without putting your name on negative ads, if you can destroy an opponent without paying any price for it, and your friends never have to have their names known and can spend all the money they want to spend to do it, this is not my idea of democracy, but that weapon's been unleashed here. And the only fairness in this thing is that Newt Gingrich is one of those on the right that supports the right of money to call itself democracy.
Chris, thank you. Joining us here in New York for our coverage tonight is Republican strategist Steve Schmidt. He was a chief strategist with the McCain-Palin campaign 4 years ago. He's now an MSNBC political analyst, also the host of The Ed Show on MSNBC, Ed Schultz. Lawrence O'Donnell, the host of The Last Word here on MSNBC, and the host of MSNBC's Politics Nation, the Reverend Al Sharpton, who himself has been a presidential candidate and knows what it is to compete in Iowa. Gentlemen, thank you all very much for being here. This is going to be a fun night already. Let me start with getting some first thoughts from you about what you think the stakes are tonight and what you're watching for. Steve?
Well, I think what tonight does is set up the next several contests, going to New Hampshire, to South Carolina, and to Florida. And if the polls are to be believed, we will see an order of finish that is Romney, that is Santorum, that's Ron Paul, a jumble. I think it's too tough to predict who's going to finish where, but there'll be three tickets out of Iowa heading into New Hampshire. You'll see some of the candidates heading directly to South Carolina, Rick Perry, Michelle Bachmann, where they'll make their last stand. We're at the point of the race now where candidates will start to get out of it because their campaigns are out of money. And I think as you look ahead tonight, I think no matter what the outcome is and the order of finish, it's going to be a pretty good night for Governor Romney, because I think it's tough to see scenarios where Senator Santorum or Ron Paul in particular are going to have much staying power.
In terms of who might go home tonight, who do you think is most at risk of doing so poorly tonight that it's the end of their campaign?
Well, I think clearly Michelle Bachmann, Governor Perry's in a lot of trouble. No one wants to be the first person to drop out. No one wants to be the first person to concede the obvious after a loss in Iowa. So they'll hang on for a little while. Presidential campaigns end when they run out of money. And there's going to be a conversation in the Perry campaign, in the Bachmann campaign, I think before very long, where people come into the room, they say, hey, Governor, hey, Congresswoman, there's no money left to pay the bills. And that's what ends the campaign.
Ed Schultz, first thoughts tonight?
Well, first thoughts are the ground game means everything in the way this is all set up. And when Rick Santorum says that they've got the organization, that means he's got people that are going to be able to stand up in these caucus meetings and make the pitch. It's a very parochial setting in Iowa. A lot of friends, a lot of neighbors, small groups. Come on, Joe, vote this way. What do you think, Johnny? A lot of that goes on. And so I think Santorum has done the groundwork, the 99 counties, the social conservatives, no matter how you look at it, they carry a big stick in Iowa. They're about 60% of the vote. And keep in mind that Huckabee won this with 40,000 votes. Mitt Romney got 30,000 votes in 2008. Question is, what has he done to build on that number? I think Santorum is the wild card here tonight. If there's a big turnout and the social conservatives are strong and they leave Bachmann and they don't spend too much time with Perry, I think Santorum could win this thing tonight. And the fact that you've got three social conservatives in this race is the best thing that could happen to Mitt Romney.
Al Sharpton, you have been in Iowa in a lot of different capacities, including running there. What are you looking for tonight in terms of the big picture?
Several things. One, turnout. It's going to be very interesting if there's a low turnout, because it will signal that these candidates don't even excite their own base. Second, how much damage they do in terms of how the American public is going to view them, because at the end of all of this, someone's going to have to run against President Obama. If they're in such an extreme right position, they can win and lose it all tonight, because there's no Democratic caucus. So they have the full stage to themselves. America's looking at them. They could lose independents. They could lose a lot of moderates tonight, even if they win the caucus, because they had to go so far to the right to win in Iowa that they lose the rest of the country. And how much damage do they do with the Citizens United rule that is cut to haunt them? They are reaping what they've sowed. They may hurt themselves so till President Obama doesn't have to do anything, because they will have destroyed themselves before the main match. So it's very funny to me, because if it was a rock band, I used to, as a kid, be around James Brown. If you kill yourself in rehearsal, the guy on the main show with you doesn't have to do anything but sing on note.
Do you feel, I mean, this is what Chris was talking about in his opening thoughts, too. Do you think that, and we always see negative ads, and we always see candidates get torn apart. Do you think that things are materially, qualitatively worse in terms of the negativity because people don't have to put their names on their ads?
When you have the night before the first caucus, we haven't even got to a primary yet, one of the candidates calling another one a liar, the other one saying the other one's too liberal. I mean, all of this is absolutely nothing but music to the ears of the DNC. Mm. And I think that they can damage each other so till it'll be hard to unite the party. And again, there's no one looking at the Democrats tonight in America. They're all looking at them. So unlike 08 and in other races, you don't have what's happening on the Democratic side, what's happening to the Republican side. You got the whole stage to yourself. Knock yourself out so the Americans can say, with one in out of every two Americans near poverty, with the income gap, these are the people that I'm going to put in charge of the country. We couldn't have wrote this script better if we did it ourselves, Rachel.
Lawrence O'Donnell, host of The Last Word. What are you looking for?
Tonight marks the end of the year of idiocy in Republican presidential campaigning, the single most embarrassing year in the history of modern presidential campaigning within a party. It had the fake candidacies that the media fell for. Most embarrassing performance year for the political media, too. They fell for Sarah Palin. They couldn't read the clues starting from the day she quit her job as governor. It was very clear she was never going to run for anything. They fell for Donald Trump. The voters, the Republican voters, fell for Donald Trump. Then they got infatuated with Michelle Bachmann. They got infatuated with impossible candidacies. So the insanity is over. The reality starts tonight, and it turns out when we get to 2012, the reality candidacies are a former governor and a former senator. Big surprise. No game show host, no junior member of Congress like Ms. Bachmann, no edgy, flaky guy like Ron Paul. It's where it's always been in Republican politics, a former senator, a former governor.
If Ron Paul places first tonight in Iowa, which I think he has a real chance to do, will that change your assessment of whether or not he's
an utterly meaningless candidacy in terms of the final outcome? What he is a decoy. He's an additional prop on this set. And he can stay on the set for a long time because all he needs is airfare to the next town to keep this thing going. He's never going to be president. He's never going to get the nomination. He represents something fascinating for Democrats, which is who are these Republicans who are voting for the most anti-war candidate since Gene McCarthy in 1968? Who are those voters? Because those voters are people that the Obama campaign should figure out how to talk to.
They are the most interesting people in American politics, mm-hmm. and I think they have been since 2008. At least that's how I've always felt about it. We're going to be joined by our political director, Chuck Todd, to take a look at what is at stake tonight by the numbers. Mr. Todd, thank you for joining us. What are you seeing at this hour?
Well, Rachel, what I'm curious about, the one advantage we have to looking at this race is Romney ran 4 years ago. So we can look at what the entrance polls said 4 years ago in Iowa and figure out motivations. And so one thing that I've been fascinated by when it comes to, and let me get our app going here tonight, is what is going to be the motivation of the voter as they go in? Are they looking for a candidate that they personally believe in more, has a core set of values, or are they looking for electability and experience? And in this case, 4 years ago, 80% of them came to Iowa looking for a candidate that connected with them on core beliefs and said what they meant. And Mike Huckabee destroyed Mitt Romney among those voters. Those that showed up, but only one in five in this case, those that showed up that way for electability and experience, if you look here, there was only 21% of them. It finally came up. You know, we're working out the kinks here right now. They went for Romney. Now, is it going to be 21% this time that shows up thinking about electability first and experience, or is it going to be, say, 35, 40%? The more people that show up tonight thinking about the general election, the better Mitt Romney does. The more it looks like 4 years ago, shares my values, core beliefs. That's a Rick Santorum electorate tonight. So that's a question we have on our entrance poll. We'll know that in about 90 minutes, we hope. And that will tell us sort of the makeup tonight. Are these Republican activists focused on their conservative beliefs, or are they simply thinking about November and beating the president?
Chuck, the Iowa caucus goer is such an experienced political animal. It's a minority of Republican voters in Iowa, and it's folks who know what they're doing and are willing to spend several hours doing it when almost nobody else in the state is. Do you find in general that they are thinking more strategically about the race, that they are thinking in terms of how it's going to affect further states, or are they voting as if they are voting essentially for the president of Iowa?
Well, and the thing is, the answer is yes. I've run into both of those types of Republican activists. And you're right. They're all sort of political analysts and pundits. You know, these are people that get involved in their local politics, so they know they're gaming this out. There's a lot of Iowa Republicans. They don't want to coronate Mitt Romney tonight. They believe eventually they'll be for him, and he's the second choice, for instance, of a lot of, for instance, Newt Gingrich and Rick Perry voters. but they want him to have to work a little bit harder to woo conservatives, that he hasn't quite done enough. They're not quite sold. And you know what? Iowa's job is to winnow the field, not simply end the race. But then there are others. I ran into this one woman who, to me, sort of epitomized who Mitt Romney was trying to woo. And she said, I love Michelle Bachmann. I wish she had a chance. She doesn't. I guess I'm going to caucus for Romney because she didn't want to be with a loser. And what I thought was interesting is last night's Mitt Romney speech, if you read it carefully, and everybody said, well, was he gaming to say that I'm going to win this thing? He was trying to send the subtle messages, hey, I'm going to win this thing. Maybe it's going to take me 5 weeks. Maybe it'll be tomorrow night. But don't you want to be with a winner? We're going to win this thing in the end and be the ones that go on to November. And I think he was trying to send that because that could have an impact on some of these guys, some of these folks that show up tonight.
And of course, the risk of that saying we're going to win is that if you don't, you've set up your own expectations, which of course is a huge part of the implication of what Iowa results mean. Chuck Todd, we'll be checking in with you later. Thank you. NBC's Ron Mott is northeast of Des Moines right now in Johnston, Iowa. He's at the Summit Middle School, home tonight to one of the larger caucuses that's happening tonight in Iowa. Ron, what can you tell us about what's happening there tonight and what you expect?
Hey there, Rachel. Good evening to you. Well, you can see they're making final preparations to get some seats down for the folks who are going to come to this middle school to caucus tonight. This is one of about 1,800 of these meetings that will take place across Iowa, all those 99 counties getting involved. And for people who don't really know what these caucuses mean, it really is what Tip O'Neill said, all politics is local. This is the community coming together. Open politics in front of everyone. And what they'll do is they'll start the meeting here with the Pledge of Allegiance. They'll have some administrative things to take care of at the top of the meeting. And then surrogates for all of the candidates will be invited to come up, make one final appeal to the voters here. We understand that former congressman from Oklahoma, J.C. Watts, a little star power, coming to speak on behalf of Newt Gingrich, trying to close the deal for him in this caucus here. So they will have their final pitches to the voters, and then they hand out blank pieces of paper to the voters. They write down who they want to support. They turn those back in. They tabulate the votes. They announce those to the crowd here and send the results off to the state headquarters. Everyone then dashes back home to turn on the televisions and the radios to see if their candidate ends the night as the leader of the pack. So it's very involved. We expect to hear a lot of applause lines coming from those surrogates who speak before these voters. They're trying to close the deal. And what's interesting is so many people said that they were coming to these caucuses tonight undecided, about 41% in this latest Des Moines Register poll. So a lot of folks may be swayed by what they hear in caucus meetings across this state tonight. So it'll be a very interesting night, Rachel.
NBC News correspondent Ron Mott, thanks. We'll be checking in with you later on. I love that the fact that people would go out on a very cold January night and be willing to spend definitely a minimum of several hours sitting around talking politics while 40% of them have not yet decided what they want to do. They're not going there for a crusade. They're not going there because they got to get something done that they know they've got to get done for a specific candidate. They're going even before they know what they want to do. I love it. All right, coming up, we will be checking in with former Republican National Committee Chairman Michael Steele, with Washington Post columnist Pulitzer Prize-winning Eugene Robinson, and we'll be talking with Ben Ginsburg from the Romney campaign. You are watching MSNBC's coverage of the Iowa caucuses. Stay with us.
The Place for Politics 2012, brought to you by Nissan. Innovation for all.
Wouldn't it be cool if you took the top down on a crossover? If there were buttons for this? If your transmission never changed gears? Wouldn't it be cool if your car could handle the kids and the Nürburgring? Or what if you built a car in Tennessee that could change the world? Yeah, that would be cool. Nissan. Innovation for today, innovation for tomorrow, innovation for all.
What started as
every day, millions of people choose to do the right thing.
Slowly turn.
There's an insurance company that does that too. Liberty Mutual Insurance. Responsibility. What's your policy?
Gentlemen, shall we join the ladies?
Meryl Streep is electrifying.
Mrs. Thatcher, welcome to the madhouse.
Astonishing.
Sink it.
magnificent. Winner, Best Actress from the New York Film Critics Circle. Golden Globe nominee Meryl Streep in the performance event of the year.
It's a war they started, but by God, we will finish it.
The Iron Lady, rated PG-13, in theaters everywhere January 13th.
Hi, I'm Henry Winkler, and I'm here to tell homeowners that are 62 and older about a great way to live a better retirement. It's called a reverse mortgage.
Call right now to receive your free DVD and booklet with no obligation. It answers questions like how a reverse mortgage works, how much you qualify for, the ways to receive your money, and more. Plus, when you call now, you'll get this magnifier with LED light absolutely free.
When you call the experts at One Reverse Mortgage today, you'll learn the benefits of a government-insured reverse mortgage. It will eliminate your monthly mortgage.